like your peace, nothing like your peace, nothing like your joy, nothing like your joy. Oh, there's nothing like your love, nothing like your love, oh God. There's nothing like your peace, nothing like your peace, nothing like your joy, nothing like your joy. There's nothing like your love, nothing like your love, oh God. Oh, there's nothing like your peace, nothing like your peace, nothing like your joy, nothing like your joy. There's nothing like your love, nothing like your love, oh God. There's nothing like your peace, nothing like your peace, nothing like your joy, nothing like your joy. There's nothing like your love, nothing like your love, oh God. There's nothing like your peace, nothing like your peace, nothing like your joy, nothing like your joy, nothing like your love, nothing like your love, oh. There's nothing like your peace, nothing like your peace, nothing like your joy, nothing like your joy. And there's nothing like your love, nothing like your love. Oh, there's nothing like your peace, nothing like your peace, nothing like your joy, nothing like your joy. Nothing like your love, nothing like your love. There's nothing like your peace, nothing like your peace, nothing like your joy, nothing like your joy. And there's nothing like your love, nothing like your love, oh God. Oh, there's nothing like your peace, nothing like your peace, nothing like your joy. Nothing like your joy, nothing like your love, nothing like your love, oh God. There's nothing like your peace, nothing like your peace, nothing like your joy, nothing like your joy. There's nothing like your love, nothing like your love, oh Lord. There's nothing like your peace. Nothing like your peace, nothing like your joy, nothing like your joy, and nothing like your love, nothing like your love. There's nothing like your peace, nothing like your peace, nothing like your joy, nothing like your joy, and there's nothing like your love, nothing like your love, oh God. There's nothing like your peace, nothing like your peace, nothing like your joy, nothing like your joy. And there's nothing like your love, nothing like your love, oh Lord. There's nothing like your peace. Nothing like your peace. Nothing like your joy. Nothing like your joy. Nothing like your love. Nothing like your love, oh God.
Thank you.
Wherever you lead me, Lord, I will follow you. And now it's your will, oh Lord, I will do. And what you desire, Lord, I desire to. Yes, what you desire, Lord, I desire to. Wherever you lead me, Lord, I will follow you. And what you desire, Lord, I desire to. And now it's your will, oh Lord, I will do. Eyes, and you are the one who gave me this new life, and you are the one who fills me deep inside. You said to me, come and dwell here at my side. You are the one who opened up these eyes, and you are the one who fills me deep inside. I will follow you. I will follow you. Lord, I will follow you. I will follow you. Yes, I will follow you. I will follow you. I will follow you. Lord, I will follow you. I will follow you. I will follow you, Lord, I will follow you. I will follow you, yes, I will follow you. Lord Jesus, we thank you that you invited us here into the presence of the Father. Holy Spirit, we ask you to take full control of everything that goes on this place so that only Jesus can be revealed. Lord, all we desire to see, Holy Spirit, all we desire to see is Jesus. Thank you so much for your saving grace. Thank you so much for your love that fills this place. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father, that we're standing in your presence. Father, I thank you right now for the authority of your word and the authority of your spirit that breaks the yoke of every mind-blinding spirit. Father, I thank you for the authority of your word and the authority of the Holy Ghost that causes every heart to see and understand this wonderful grace that you've given. Now in the name of Jesus Christ and by the power that is in his name, I take the blood of Jesus Christ and I sprinkle it on everybody in this place. I apply it to your life and to your heart, that everything that God has in his grace will be freely received by your life in Jesus' name. Freely received in the name of Jesus into your heart, into your life right now, so that out of your belly flow rivers of living water. Hallelujah. So that out of your belly will flow rivers of living water. Father, thank you for the mighty grace that you've given. Thank you for the mighty name of Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 Right now, doesn't matter where you come from, what you've done, where you've been. Right now, every sin, every wrongdoing, everything that has separated you from Jesus, everything that has separated you from the living God can be washed away, can be totally removed, absent from your life and even your thinking. Just turn your heart towards Jesus right now. He paid the price in full for you. Turn your heart towards him right now. Might as well not wait till the end of the meeting. Let everything that belongs to the love of God come fill you right now. Let everything that belongs to the peace of God come fill you right now. Let everything that belongs to this joy unspeakable come fill you right now. Receive healing into your body right now in the name of Jesus. Everything that belongs to division, everything in your life that maybe is a hurt, has caused unforgiveness, removed right now in Jesus' name. Every tragedy, every hardship of your life that has plagued your thoughts, removed right now in Jesus' name. Removed. Now just lift your hands towards heaven. Let God touch you. Let God, the Holy Ghost, he's here. Let him touch you. The doubts, the propaganda and lies of Satan that would try to speak against the truth that is in Jesus Christ, try to hide the truth that is here in this love and grace of God, removed from off of you now in Jesus' name. Now in Jesus' name. Now in Jesus' name. This glory of heaven flows into your life. This peace of God flows into your life right now. Hallelujah. This goodness of God, this acceptance by God through Jesus Christ, right now in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Say, Lord Jesus, I thank you for your saving grace. I thank you that you purchased me with your own blood. I thank you that you filled me with the Holy Spirit. I thank you, Lord, that you've anointed me to be able to walk with you. Hallelujah. 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 Well, you can be seated. Welcome, everybody. We're glad to have you here. We're especially happy that Evangelist Tim Hall is here. He's going to be with us today, tonight at 6 o'clock. On Monday night at 7 o'clock, on Tuesday night at 7 o'clock, and on Wednesday night at 7 o'clock. That's the plans for now.
The reality of it is that right behind these walls is a 33,000 square foot building that can hold about 3,000-4,000 people. If you don't put chairs all the way through it, I mean, probably could hold 3,000-4,000 people if you stack the chairs right. But I mean, we cram a lot of people in there. And then of course, you know, if that's not big enough, we can put screens up outside, projectors up outside, let people come stand in the parking lot. If that's not big enough, we can move down the street to this Qualcomm Stadium there. I mean, so we all have to wonder, what hinders the revival? What hinders the move of God? What hinders the things that the Father wants to do to convince all the world of how much He loves all of them? I mean, if He spared not His own Son, but delivered Him up for us all, how much more shall He also freely give to us everything that we need by Him? I was in Japan not too long ago, and I was just lamenting that the largest city in the nation, largest city, forgive me, in the world, Tokyo, was so unreached, that the church was so insignificant, that the average size of the church is 20 to 30 people at most. When I first heard that, I said, my goodness gracious, there must be a lot of churches then. And then the person who was driving us around said, no, about 800, maybe 1,000. And the Spirit of the Lord woke me up early in the morning and said, listen, I have all authority. Jesus said, all authority is given to me in heaven and earth. And you can be sure that Jesus said that. You know how you can be sure? You can turn to Matthew chapter 28, verse 21. You'll be sure that Jesus said that. And He just said it personally to me. That's what He does with His word, you know. He takes His word and He makes it personal revelation to our hearts. We don't need any other instruction. He's given us all we need. If we just start doing everything that He's given us to do, there wouldn't be anything left to do anyways. Huh? He's the final word. The final word was spoken. His name is Jesus. Hallelujah. And the Spirit of the Lord said, all authority is given me in heaven and earth. I'm just looking for someone to agree with me to go. This place is unreached by the power of the living God. I don't care today. There's over 3 million people in San Diego County. It wouldn't matter to me today if there were 1 million people in this city in church. But we know there are not that many people in church in this city. There would still be 2 million that are in darkness and cannot see and blind to the things that Satan is doing against them and that God wants to do for them. And as far as you and I are concerned, what our purpose and responsibility is to take a hold of the power of God that has been made available and do something with it to change the way the situation is coming down upon the people's lives around us. Satan is winning in the case of many souls. And it's not supposed to be that way. At least they're supposed to have one opportunity to see. At least they're supposed to have one opportunity to really know, to experience the manifest presence of God. I probably would imagine that most people in this city have heard about religion. They've heard about your flavor and everybody else's flavor of religion. But I dare say that few have experienced the manifest presence of God. That revival shaking, heart awakening presence of the living God. Here's what I hear the Spirit of the Lord saying. Let His praises fill your heart. That His praises will fill this place. So that His praises will fill all the earth. Oh, Father, I pray in the name of Jesus that from this day forward, everybody will live over in this wonderful realm of goodness and thanksgiving in You. Just before Evangelist Tim Hall comes, I just want to spend just a little bit just talking to you about God's great love for you and the provision that He has for you. Some people act like God's going to come and do something for them, you know, all over again that He hasn't already provided and settled it. I heard so many people say, I was praying, but the heavens were as brass. You know, that's all nonsense because heavens aren't brass. Fact of it is, Jesus standing at the door of your heart and He's banging on your heart. If there's anything brass, it's the heart of men. Heaven's not brass. Jesus banging at the door of your heart saying, open up, I'll come in and I'll fellowship with you. When I fellowship with you, I'm telling you, when we abide in him and he abides in us in that kind of a fellowship way, whatever we ask, Father's going to do it for us. That's the fruit that he demands. It's just that we're going to have to get out of the circumstances, the situations, the hardships, the hurts, the disappointments of the past, and move into a confidence of relationship with him so that nothing else really is important to us. And when that's the truth, then the doubt and the unbelief, the things that hold you back, go out of the way and move out of the way. You know, there's this wonderful thing that we've received. It's called an anointing. Huh. And in 1 John 2:20, the Spirit of the Lord says this, that we have an anointing from the Holy One and we know everything. And that is pretty radical. I mean, let's talk about sounding arrogant. I know everything. Well, no. He said, we received an anointing from the Holy One. We've been given a divine provision of the Holy Ghost who's come to teach us and lead us and guide us to show us everything about the Father, to show us everything about the Lord Jesus. Isn't that amazing? To think, people say, oh, I'd like to know God as Moses knew him. Oh, I'm telling you right now, there's an opportunity made available to you that goes beyond that which Moses had. And you know, I was staring at Deuteronomy chapter 1, I believe it's verse 17 yesterday, just in awe of how that, you know, the Lord says to my prophets, I will appear to them and reveal myself to them by visions and by dreams. But it's not so with Moses. Sorry, it's not verse 17, it's like 8 or 9, isn't it? But not so with my servant Moses. I'm going to come talk to him panim vapanim, face to face. I come to him and not talk to him mouth to mouth. We're going to have a conversation. I don't hold anything back from him because he's faithful. In all his house, he's faithful. In all his house, he's talking about the whole house of Israel, the whole house of Abraham. He's faithful. Faithfulness goes a long way. Dear people, I'm going to tell you right now, Satan attacks you and fights against you concerning your faithfulness. Faithfulness in the way that you walk out your life in a relationship with him every day. Faithfulness in knowing that God can be trusted, that he loves you. Faithfulness in doing the things that has been made very clear that you're supposed to do. Faithfulness in your giving, faithfulness in your time, faithfulness in being willing to come aside and apart from all the things that would distract you and demand your full attention in this life and be alone with the Lord for a little while, every day. One day I was really busy and I have a consecrated time with the Lord. I mean, I really have set myself to praying without ceasing. I've set myself to following Paul's example and praying in the Holy Ghost more than you all. But I also have a consecrated time to be with the Lord. And one day we were really busy, lots of things were going on. And I just stopped everything. I mean, there was a lot of situations placing demand on me. But I went ahead and just said, wait a minute, I've got time. I'm going to go set myself apart from all of this and go talk with the Lord as I normally do. And so I excused myself from the situation I was in. And I discovered the Lord was there waiting for me. It shocked me. This only happened a couple years ago, about 3-4 years ago. I mean, I always knew that there was, you know, I know about fellowship, I know about relationship, but you know what? Every day our eyes become opened to the reality of all that it really is, that all of his desires really are towards us. He really wants to cause our eyes to see, our ears to hear, our hearts to understand. And he recognizes that we're so busy with so many things and that we're filled with the sense realm and that we got all these things we think that we need to do, and then we ultimately no longer are willing to prioritize him. But we make him first. I think there's nothing that touches Father's heart deeper. There's nothing that is more endearing to him. I'm going after, and I pray you'll follow me. If you want to lead the way, that's fine, but you better start running. I want to go after all the fullness of the measure, the maturity of the ministry of Jesus. I'm not going to let up. I'm not going to sit back and say, you know, I've done this, I've done that. And after all, I've spoke to so many people over the years, and they act like, you know, if I begin to talk to them about a deeper relationship, they act like I'm talking offensive language. For me, that's heaven speaking. That's not, pride of life would make it something different though, wouldn't it? But I'm telling you, God has given us an anointing.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He laboro sataya.
You know what the anointing means? You know what the anointing is from the Old Testament to the New Testament? It's the divine manifest presence of God that authorizes you. It's the divine presence of the living God that brings you protection against all your enemies. The shield of His anointing. The anointing. It is that divine provision of God that takes care of you as the suzerain or the benefactor to supply all that you have need of. So that if you're walking in the wilderness for 40 years, your shoes will not wear out. Your clothes will not lose any of its fabric quality. We pray in the name of Jesus that you'll come to know the Holy Spirit. We pray in the name of Jesus that you come to admire and honor and appreciate the anointing to where that is more important to you than any single thing that exists. We help you. The anointing is manifested a number of different ways. It's manifested in the life of Jesus Christ. It's manifested in the manifest presence of the Lord, the workings of the Holy Ghost. It's manifested in the ministries that the Lord has placed within the church for your perfection, special gifts. People are always talking about gifts, you know? And they should, because gifts are good. And everybody should want to participate with the gifts of the Spirit just because you get to participate with the Holy Ghost on a deeper level. And that's beautiful and wonderful. And the more you get to experience Him, the better off you are, because that's abundant life. But God's given special gifts. And I'm not going to stand here and try to, as it were, magnify my office and give somebody a reason to have to try to honor me more or whatever, because that's not the point of it. The point is this. Papa has given special gifts to the church for your perfection. And if you don't know how to honor them, the supply of heaven will never be able to flow to you. When I was young, because I'm still young. I'm only 55 years old. I forget, but when I was younger, when I was new in the Lord, I would watch, and I hadn't barely been functioning in the gifts of healing much. But there were people around me who just thought I was really just something special in God. Every one of them got healed as soon as I looked at them. I just barely said, you don't need to have that. They get healed. And then I knew that. I had already watched that in other people's lives. As long as people honored the men of God, what was in the man of God's life was able to be received into other people's lives as well. Unfortunately, Satan knows that, and so he runs interference against that and tries to bring separation between that provision that God has brought into our lives and us, so that the flow of the things of heaven never reach us. And people, I want to just help you understand. Forgive me, I don't have a speech impediment. I'm a little drunk in the Holy Ghost. We call it that way. We call it drunk because it's just a little bit of speech impairment, sense realm impairment. You're more comfortable speaking in the heavenly language than an earthly one. But we stay as sober as we possibly can for your cause, so that you can hear these things, understand these things. Once again, we're not trying to magnify our office. We're not trying. But God has given special gifts to the church: apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers. One thing that we are dedicated to is being very connected with the church of the Lord Jesus Christ. The expression of the Lord, church of the Lord Jesus Christ throughout the earth. There are things that I'm just not going to connect with, because they're aberrations from the Word of God. I'm just not going to connect with it. It's not solidly revealed in the Word. There's too much in the Word of God that we're not doing that needs to be solidly revealed. I'm staying on that track. I'm not. Are you with me? And I'm so blessed to have, that we have as a church, I have in my personally, that my family has in our relationship with Evangelist Tim Hall, because the Lord has done so many things, wonderful things through his life. And the anointing that flows from Christ Jesus, the head, when we hold the head properly, flows to every part and member of the body when there is that wonderful Holy Ghost connection. And it's wonderful to be connected with the church of the Lord Jesus Christ throughout the earth, isn't it? The power of the local ministry is absolutely
unquestionable. The authority of the local church is absolutely unquestionable, especially in the context of when it stands hand in hand with the church that the Lord Jesus Christ has throughout the entirety of the earth. Real quickly, I want to just point out to you that you have received an anointing. You can say, who, me? I'll say, yes, you. You have received an anointing. If you've been born of God, you've received an authorization to function as a son of God. Not as any son of God, but as the Son of God. Not as a son of God like Adam, not as a son of God as an angel, but as the only true and only model that is expressed in the Word of God for you and me to follow, the Son of God. Authorized. I'm authorized. You're authorized. A lot of things to try to stand in the way of that authorization. But we authorized, hallelujah, because that's what the anointing does, Old Testament and New Testament. It authorizes you to be a king. It authorizes you to be a priest. It authorizes you to be a prophet. It authorizes you to stand in His presence. Though there were few in the past that were allowed to do that, all men everywhere are invited to come in. And when that becomes more important to us and more valuable and more awesome and more wonderful than anything else, hallelujah, then we'll receive that much more, and the honor of the anointing will be expressed in every area of our life, and we'll receive that much more, and all that He has for us will be a living reality in our life. This morning, before Tim comes, I want to give you an opportunity to honor the Lord with your offerings and with your tithes that came directly to you as a provision from God, because He is your benefactor. He is your suzerain. See, Satan can't touch you. You know why Satan can't touch you? Can I tell you why Satan can't touch you? Because the anointing protects you against your enemies. Hallelujah. Do you know how we understand why you don't have to worry about your daily bread and your provision? Can we tell you why you don't have to worry? Because the anointing brings the provision of God to you so that all of your needs are supplied according to His riches and glory by Jesus, the Anointed One. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And then what we do is we come to Him and just in honor of Him. We want to go into, so many folks have held back from fully trusting the Lord. We want to come into a place of worshiping that expresses great trust for Him, that expresses great confidence in Him, that expresses that we believe what He says. And so that's why fathers always called for the offering. Some people hold back the offering. They don't want to give the offering. Don't do that. You have nobody to follow in the Bible if you should live such a life. I would have run the risk of being that wrong. You with me? Huh? Then put your treasure where it needs to be. Can you hear me? You can't take it with you anyways. Might as well go ahead and prove God. You know, there's really only one place that God said, prove me. Did you know that? Did you know that the Lord only gave one dimension for man to prove Him in? Only one means by which we could evaluate Him, as it were, to prove Him? Did you know that? Did you know that? He said, prove me with your tithes and with your offerings. See if I don't do what I'm going to tell you I do. See if I won't be what I said I'd be. See if I won't accomplish those things which I promised you I would accomplish. You say, but you don't understand my mortgage. Yeah, I understand. But you didn't understand, I just got a new car and we're running behind on the payments. Yeah, I understand. But you didn't understand, we don't have enough food in the house. Yeah, I understand. But see, I've already got an answer for every one of those statements. I've got a widow who's about to die with her son and eat the last meal. And the prophet of God said, give it to me first. And the provision never ran out because the anointing came into her life. She hooked up with the anointing by obeying the word of the Lord. And she prospered. Hallelujah. From that day forward, she had plenty. Amen. Today I pray in Jesus' name. And I look across this church at the people that are here today. And I'm so blessed that you're here. There's so many that aren't here for one reason or the other. I hope they're not watching by web, because the web's only for people who can't make it earning driving distance. But at any rate, I'm so blessed by the people that are here because you give, you continue to give, you pour out your life. Don't stop. Watch how God's blessing you, huh? I believe everybody in this place could stand up and talk about how God's blessed them, how there's always been provision, how there's never been any lack. Huh? There's never been any lack. Somebody said, yeah, but we've been in some tight spots. But yeah, you got out of them all, didn't you? Hallelujah. I know a lot of people have been in tight spots, and those tight spots turned into disaster. Didn't turn into disaster for God's people. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Can America be saved? Can a nation be born in a day? Can revival sweep this land again? Could it be like, I'm hoping that Tim shares some of the great stories of revivals of the past and tells you about crossing the line and some of these other great stories that he's had as a part of his life that ultimately brought people, their testimonies of how people came into a consecrated life of selling out to God. Selling out to God. So that everything that belongs in the realms of heaven could be expressed through their lives. That cultures could be changed and nations could be changed. And awakenings could come. An awakening that God is here. And that he loves us so desperately. In the mighty name of Jesus. Sell out to God and begin by the offering of those things that you have that you call money. Can't serve two masters. Today, serve the master with your finances. Don't try to get the master to serve your finances. Huh? Too many people try to get the master to serve their finances instead of using their finances to serve the master. Amen. Hallelujah. I pray today you waste everything you got on Jesus. That's the way Judas saw it. You know that? What a waste. She came and brought a whole year's worth of money and poured it out on him. I pray you waste all your money on Jesus today. Jesus had a very different look of it, didn't he? He looked at it very differently, didn't he? No, he saw this woman honoring him. He saw this woman witnessing to the power of his death, burial, and resurrection to the offering. Over and again, you'll find the offering is a memorial. We talk about fire. Fire is all about the manifest presence of God coming down and saying the offering is acceptable. Some of you say fire has got to come to make the offerings acceptable. That's not true. The heart makes the offering acceptable. And when the offering is acceptable and it's done according to the way Papa said, because many people say, well, the Lord knows my heart, but they're not doing it the right way. The heart makes the offering right when it's done just like Father said, just the offering that he wants you and I to bring. His fire comes. You authorized. You've been given something that's called power, the kavod. The power. In the power is the authorization, the protection, the provision. Because that is the fire cloud of God that comes upon our life, which is a mantle called the anointing. It is the manifest presence of the Lord in our life. Jesus is standing at the door of your heart. He's knocking right now. If you'll open up, he will come in. When he comes in, you authorized. When he comes in, you protected against your enemies. You'll tread upon scorpions and serpents and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt you. You authorized by the power of his presence. Amen. So everybody, just stand with me. I just want you to stand. You're going to present yourself right now, a living sacrifice. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Whew. Just presume. Right now, I present you. The Lord Jesus said, holy and acceptable. Everybody wants to be presented holy and acceptable. You being presented right now. You, somebody might say, all I have is just a little. With Papa, a little becomes much. He takes a little bit and he multiplies it. The Lord has shown me that we'll do the same miracles. The Lord has personally shown me that we will do the same miracles that he did in greater works. You know how he personally told me? John 14:12. He personally showed me. I went to that and he personally showed me. has any personally made it known to me. I was in Papua New Guinea one day, and the Lord spoke to me when I did that Assemblies of God conference. And the Lord spoke to me and said, have communion, and I'll turn the water into wine. And I was all set for him, and I'm just such a supercharge of faith. But Joe Maru got in the big middle of it, and he demanded that lemonade be made from the Kool-Aid, not lemonade, Kool-Aid. Yeah, and then, you know, I didn't want him to bring out any bread. I was just going to see that bread get multiplied, just one matzo. And they brought it out Papua New Guinea style, where they rolled it all up into little balls so everybody could eat it really well. And the white bread turned black bread. But we went, never mind. We're still going to do it. We're still going to see the water turn to wine. We're still going to do it. We're still going to see the bread multiply. We're still going to see communion on the level that the Lord wants to do it. We're going to still see these signs and wonders. Hey, listen, I'm telling you right now, I was fascinated as a young child by the book, Like a Mighty Wind. But I'm telling you right now, and Mal Tari lives right up the road here. And, you know, he's been a friend for a long time. But God's Father has not done. He said, Father, he's not finished. You're not going to back and camp around what God did last year or 10 years ago. I'm not going to be talking about what God did with my life or somebody else's life last month. We're going to talk about what God's doing now and what the things he's planning for us to do tomorrow. And you have to step into a realm of faith, and that faith begins with your pocketbook. And if you hold back your pocketbook from God, you hold back your heart from God. And I don't care what you believe, this is what the Bible believes. Are you listening to me? I'm going to get a little forceful now because I'm pastor. People say, could you help me understand, pastor? Parent. Not psychologist, not facilitator, parent. Somebody said, I'm too old to be parent. Parented. Never. Say never. No one's too old to be parented. Amen. Somebody said, well, how do you know that? Because I see what a pastor is taking care of the cows and the sheep and the goats. I'm going to tell you, that's a serious level of parenting. Amen. Hallelujah. Father, thank you for the anointing of the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father, that every heart's right now. And if heart wasn't right before, it's made right now. And you don't need to grieve or wonder or hurt or worry anymore. Right now, in Jesus' name, I command you be made right. Right now, in Jesus' name. Right now, open up the prison door. You come out and you stand here in the presence of God and feel peace in Jesus' name. Amen. So just come worship the Lord with your tithes and with your offerings. Come on in. Then come on in. And then as you do, after you worship the Lord with your offerings, then what I want you to do is I want you to find somebody, hug them. Hug them and tell them that you love them. And here, take this microphone.
I will do. Thank you very much.
You're in charge.
I'm in charge. Oh, well, good morning, folks. I'm just going to leap up these steps like a gazelle. Look at this, look straight. Oh, there we go. Up the stairs like a gazelle.
Brethren, we've come together today in the sight of Almighty God, that yea, indeed, the blessing would fall. We implore thee, O God, by the utter benevolence of thy goodness, that we, mortal worms, not men, may somehow connect with thy deity. Amen. We'd like to tell you that the Ladies Guild will be selling marmalade and preservatives after the meeting. And in a few moments, I shall be preaching a very powerful word from the Reader's Digest.
Look at all these kids growing. What are we being fed? What are you being fed on, Jacob? Stand up, Jacob, please. Come here. Come here immediately. Just come right up here. Now, you are nearly as tall as Josiah now. How is this happening?
I don't know.
Don't know? You are growing quite strong. Let me just check. Flex. Hey, that's not bad, actually. That's very, very good. Have you been very good for Mum and Dad? Good. Well, thanks for that. Thanks for coming up. Anything you want to say to the congregation? A few comments? Nothing really? All right. Have a nice day. I like all the kids in this church. Let me go through, see if I can remember half of them. Once I start, I'm in trouble. Josiah. Josh, Caleb, Jonathan, who used to be little. Stand up, Jonathan. What on earth do they feed you? I remember all these kids used to come up for drawings. And I'm going to stop there because I've got 100% result at this point. Where's little Ruthie? I remember her when she was 11. Yesterday, just I want to brag on her for a moment. I always arrive here for her graduations, and this year they had to have a fire to postpone for 1 week. So I'm sorry about the fire that went through there, but that was my fault. That was for me. But congratulations on your graduation, and you are now a bachelor. She doesn't look like a bachelor, does she? A bachelor. Anyway, there we are. How are you doing, Rob? Looking good. Randy? Brad? Mrs. Brad? Fantastic. Well, that's the greetings. And to everyone else here, that's as far as I'm going to go because I really have 100% hit there. After that, I may fall away and offend someone. It is great to be here. It's great. And I like the building. I nearly fell down the stairs. I didn't see the stair. At the last minute, God said, look out. I was about to go over the falls. There'd have been this almighty smash there, and it probably would have triggered off quite a serious earthquake. It would have been the one that people have been worrying about for years. I would have triggered it, and it wouldn't have been good. Do you feel good this morning? I had a good night the other night. I went to Disneyland. They had it was all day, 24-hour Disney. I made it to about 1 o'clock, went on the car ride a few times, and it was an interesting night. I won't go into detail, but we enjoyed it. Where's Dan? Where are you, Dan? Dan! Where is he? He's gone. In the kids' church. We've had a great few months, the last few months. Would you like me to show you some of the stuff we've been doing? Yes?
Yes.
Really?
Yes.
No, I don't think so. No. All right. I'll just show you a couple of things. I've got to be careful I don't walk down there. I've walked off a lot of platforms. Oh, my gosh, this is going to be... Whoop! Because it's the same colour. I'm nearly blind in this eye. I've walked off 2 platforms. One was about that high. And I went straight down, bang, like a beached whale. It wasn't really bang, it was splat. And The other one was up in New Guinea. I got on the stairs. I've told you the story four or five times, but you've forgotten. And for 23 nights in the National Stadium, I had begged them to put a rail up for the stairs, because stairs are not my greatest strength. I'm anti-stairs. I believe they're a thing created by the devil. But the last night, it was raining, and I put my foot on the top step. My foot went, and I went straight down headfirst into the running track and didn't feel a thing. No headache. I was covered in mud. I'm not sure if some of the words that I'd learnt before I was saved may have come very close. And then I was looking around for a Papua New Guinean to kill. But they're all gone. I could see them in the trees. All I could see in the trees was blinking eyes, and no one was smiling. And one poor Papua New Guinean was silly enough to come up and say, "Pastor, you all right?" And then I said, "I've only been asking for a rail for 23 nights. Do I have to?" He took off. He was gone. I walked around the corner with mud right down my shirt, walked around the corner going, "God, I've just fallen off the platform. I'm covered in mud. The international evangelist is here doing his big crusade, praying and ministering under the anointing, and I'm covered in mud." It's a wet night. And I walked around the corner and they brought a girl up that was blind in both eyes, and they just were flickering like this. Their eyes were just all over the place like this. And I was in a bad mood, ready to kill. I actually had a murderous intent for any Papua New Guinean that I could see. And as this girl came around the corner, I laid my hands upon her in Jesus' name. Bingo, both the eyes went straight. And the Lord said to me, I'm not sure if it was the Lord or just an impression I had. It was probably just an impression, but there was this funny thought went through my head. "Tim, I can use you even when you're acting like a mental case." So, any rate, without further ado, let me just show you a couple of pictures. Let's pop them up there. I'll get out. I'll try not to walk off there. Pop one up there. Do we need double click to edit? That was in, last year, I went and did some meetings in a church that I had pastored. We had a revival in that church, and when I say revival, the church went from about 70 people to somewhere around about 700 in 18 months. And we were baptizing 30 or 40 a month, and it was a great time. Then when I handed over to another man to take it on, he didn't invite me back for 30 years. So I hadn't been back for 30 years, and I went back, and we had a real move of God. The place was packed out. And if I'm in someone's road here, I'll try and just move again. Somewhere back here, maybe play a tune for you. And they said, "Would you go to Myanmar? There's opportunity to go to Myanmar. It's under military rule, and it's been very closed." And I thought, I missed out on going to Nepal, so I'm not missing out on Myanmar. So I said, "Absolutely." And they said, "Is there a chance you could get the Planet Shakers band to go?" I said, "I think we can do that as well." So we went in. And in four nights, we had 86,000 come through in four nights. And every miracle you could imagine, lining the deaf up. We have got an incredible piece of footage of one girl that was healed, and she began to shriek and scream, and then she ran, and then she started doing somersaults down the ground. You've seen that, Dan, haven't you? Out in the children's church, he's gone. But this is one of the nights there. Let's have a look at another one here. That's Papua New Guinea. We've been up there. I'm going back in August. We've got an area that'll seat 50,000 people. We're taking the Planet Shakers band, and we should get 40 or 50,000 a night there in August. Next one, that was in Rodney Howard Brown's church last year. Had I showed you that? It was a good night. We had that was a morning. We had 1,408 decisions that morning. It was Riverfest morning, and I've got 9 walkers there, but they kept on coming, walking sticks and walkers, and I thought, that is America. That's not India or Africa or Pakistan. That's America that happened. And I remember ministering in Fiji a few... Why am I up the back here? I said Fiji a few years ago, and the power of God came down. I was in the National Stadium in Suva, and the power of the Holy Ghost came down like a fire, and the miracles just broke out, and there was... one of the first ones up was a man who'd been blind and unable to walk for years. He had his crutches in the air, and he was seeing everything. And then as he walked onto the platform, then he saw Jesus, and that finished him right off. And he began shrieking and screaming and threw the crutches. And then a girl came onto the platform who had never walked, and she'd been paralyzed. She came onto the platform. For the next hour, they were coming up. Finally, they were rolling people onto the platform, and they were being miraculously healed. And the Lord spoke to me, and he said, what you're seeing here now, you're going to see city by city, nation by nation, across the earth. I remember being in a... And so I want to see this. We were just in Modesto, California last week, and a lady was in a wheelchair, oxygen bottle on her wheelbarrow. What do you call them? Wheelchair. Not a wheelbarrow. People don't get around in wheelbarrows normally. Some do, not many. I try to avoid it myself. But she was in the wheelchair, and she was right at the end. There's so many Calebs in this church, it's just ridiculous. How many Calebs? Every Caleb in this church, lift your hand quickly, please. Some of them got red hair, some have got brown, blue, green. There's only two. We lost a few, lost some Calebs. But anyway, getting back to that, I just got sidetracked for a moment. Just slightly sidetracked. What was I talking about? This lady was in the wheelchair, and she was about to leave. She was waiting for prayer, and she waited, and she was at the bottom of the stairs. And I tend to, you know, I'll try and get people up on the platform to avoid having to go up and down stairs. It's just by choice. And so I was leaving it and saying, just wait, madam, I won't be long. I'll be down there. And I kept bringing people up, and she got a little bit impatient at the end. And I said, I'll just be 1 minute. And I see her taking off, and I said, bring her back. Bring the woman back here, like an evangelist. Play it, Cheryl. Bring her back. And down she came. I went down, laid hands on her. Next thing, she went zoop, took the oxygen out, got out of the wheelchair, and she started walking around. I said, well, I'm in it. So I jumped in the wheelchair, and she was pushing me around the building. The only setback was I got stuck in the chair, couldn't get out of it. So, you know, that isn't, it's not a great picture, is it, really? I went to stand up, and the chair came up with me. It was like I got up, and a chair sort of, this is not a great picture. But then we had paralyzed arms being healed, people being touched by the power of God. This is an awesome day. This is an awesome day of opportunity. And one of the things I'm finding is that when I first started to come to America, it was in about 1988. And when I first came here, I used to find it very hard, very tough. To get people saved, to get people healed was just so difficult when I first came here. Everything was buoyant. The economy was fantastic. Everybody was getting, everyone was just, there was no problems. You didn't have any, I mean, you got no real political problems or anything like that, or any difficulties with finance or debt much in America now. Back then, the country was just buoyant. But to go into churches and get things happening was darn difficult. Now I'm finding that it's America to minister, I'm seeing the results that I used to see in India, Pakistan, Thailand. 150 got saved last Sunday morning. The meeting. And Rodney says 1,408 decisions. I'd never seen anything like that in America. I have a feeling that for all the talk of doom and gloom, I think God is getting ready. I sort of feel that the hair of Samson may be growing back. I think Samson may have been pretty bald and pushing that big wheel, but you have the feeling that just maybe Samson's hair just could well be growing back. And it may just be that there's one last big go, because Samson in his last big effort killed more Philistines in that one moment when he pulled down those great pillars. He killed more in those last moments. He had the greatest impact, had an anointing to kill. killed more in that last great, pulled down the temple of Dagon, ripped it down, and had the greatest impact of his life when his hair regrew. I think America is getting ready for its greatest days. It looks, there's a lot of stuff that looks bleak, but that's the time when God finds the right people to do the right things. God's getting ready to shock us. Do you believe that? How many believe that? I want to be shocked. Remember, did I preach? I think I told you last time I was here, probably I was talking about being shocked, did I? You don't remember anything I shared about last time, do you? Who can remember what I preached on last time I was here? I've got no idea. Do you remember? What was it? Power of God, that's all I preach about. I've only got one message, I just wrap it in different paper. It's like you get the same birthday present every time I preach, just in blue paper 1 week, yellow, red. Different card, different paper, different ribbon, same message. We've all only got about one. That's right, isn't it, Pastor? Are you all okay? You happy this morning?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
I feel like royalty up here. This is like being one of those old Methodists. You know, they used to go up the stairs and wind up and look down from some box like you're in a pirate ship. Let's have a look at the next one. This was in Serbia. Was I going to Serbia last time I was here? Or had I been? I've been twice anyway in the last year. I've been twice. This was the first time. This little kid had never heard or spoken. Not a word. She'd been in total silence and couldn't speak. And she came up, little grey face, little sad little face, laid hands on her, and she lit up like a bulb of light had just been triggered in her face. She just lit up. And she came up this time. We were just there a few weeks ago. In fact, I've just come back from Serbia and Turkey, was preaching over there and took some time and drove down to Ephesus and Pergamum and Sardis and missed Thyatira. We drove through there in the daytime and it was raining and we missed the ruins and kept going, and I feel like an idiot for that. But that was extraordinary. Turkey is extraordinary. But we went over there this year and we took two professional footballers from England, Premier League players, and they did training sessions for the kids, for all these gypsy kids. These gypsy kids have got nothing. They're 90% unemployed and they have nothing, but they are the most extraordinary people, wonderful people, most incredible musicians you'll ever hear. And the first year we went in, the crusade was in a street. We were packed into a big street. And I looked at one stage and there was a balcony of a house and I wondered how well it was built because there were 58 people standing on the balcony. And all it needed was for me to get on the balcony and they would have all gone. The thing would have gone down. I said, whatever you do, go over there and get people out from under it. If they go down, the fall might be all right for the ones in the balcony, but the ones down below, they'll get killed, so get them out. But they stayed there, and I was just praying that the ground wouldn't shake with the anointing too much. A little bit, yes, but not too much. But we had a lot saved. We must have had 5,000-6,000 saved in the first trip, maybe more, maybe 10. And then we went back and we took the footballers in and we took a 6,000-seat stadium and it all broke out. We had the kids playing soccer and teams and matches, and I said to the young guy leading it, I said, what do these kids think of being in here? He said, most of them have never been in here, never seen the inside, never been allowed in. Now they're playing here. And their little faces were lit up like a Christmas tree. And I said, have you been in? He said, no, I've been in it, never been in here before either. And now we've got Portsmouth Football Club going to give them jumpers and going to help them with their football and get them in with the Serbian people. But then we had the crusade and I don't know how many got saved. Government officials were getting saved. The police were so impressed that the Serbs don't get on with the gypsies at all, don't like them. They treat them like probably like a Jew would treat a Samaritan. And the chief policeman, he sent his son to go and play soccer. And the boy came and kicked a winning goal and got a trophy. And the police were sending their kids in and something's starting to break. So we've been sending in guys that are teaching, pastors that are coming in and teaching. And last year we had 120 pastors come in, some of them with up to 60 churches, and we're working on a plan to meet the Romani or the Gypsy people right through Europe, right through Europe, right through, right through, Right through. Right through. There is, I love that scripture in Psalm 78. It's the story in Psalm 78 concerning Israel. And everything about it, if you do it in reverse, you'll have a victory. The children of Ephraim being armed and carrying bows turned back in the day of the battle. Well, I look at all this in reverse, and I think if I do it in reverse, we're going to have something unlimited. They refused his covenant. They forgot his works and so on. And then it says, they turned back and they limited the Holy One of Israel. And I really felt the Lord say to me, I want you to take the limitations off. I want you to take off the limitations. I want you to start to say nothing is impossible. I find that God continually says, with men, this is impossible, but with God, nothing shall be impossible. If you're able to believe, nothing is impossible. There is a mindset. Christians are locked in. When the wall went down, I was in Estonia just after the wall went down. We had an incredible move of God in Estonia. We had the former Communist Cultural Center, big head of Stalin outside. And we came in as soon as we could after the doors were opening. And I remember going into Estonia, and I can't even remember what I was going to tell you now. What was I telling you? Taking off the limitations. I have no idea what I was going to tell you. What was I telling you? I went into Estonia. I know it was pretty incredible. I know it was incredible. We finished up on a Russian nuclear submarine base preaching. And I had all these guys sitting there, officers, their wives, their children, maybe a crowd like this. And we had a singer that was going to sing while we shared with them, the ones that got saved. The only problem is that every person in the room got saved. Everyone, officers and submarine drivers. There's some Russian nuclear submarine captains getting around that are driving their submarine up periscope. And then we got on the train and went up to St. Petersburg. But I remember going into Russian prisons where 43 people have been murdered the previous year, and going in there and the power of God flowing through that place. I remember the miracles breaking out in the former Communist Cultural Center that were sweeping that place, so that doctors were coming in and saying, how is this person hearing? How is that person walking? I remember being there and thinking, there are no limits. There are no limits. I've got to get the limits off. I'm 66 this year I turn. Two-thirds of the way to a century this year. Two-thirds of the way to a century. And I'm frustrated because all the things that I've dreamed haven't yet come to pass. I mean, I'm frustrated. I've seen some great stuff happen, but I want to take the limitations off. I want to... Anyone with me? I want to take them off. I think we live... That's what I was going to tell you. That is what I was going to tell you. See, it's come back to me now. I needed to give you a couple of stories in the middle. When they came out, when the people in Estonia and the state and the countries that were under Soviet rule came out, and people can say what they like about socialism and communism. I've seen enough of it in Eastern Europe to know that it is nonsense. And capitalism can have its insanities too. I rather like Bible economics. Amen. You don't seem with me right here at the moment. Bible economics. Bring the whole tithe into the storehouse. There might be meat in the Father's house. Jesus said, my meat is to do the will of him who sent me, to accomplish it. And we can't do the will of God unless there's meat in the storehouse. And meat's not meat. It's not a hamburger or a slab of steak. It is financial substance with which we can fulfill the destiny. People say, why should I sow into church so that we can do the will of him who sent us? And the mentality there, even though they came out of communism, the limitations of communism were still on their minds. Even though freedom had come, it's like that gorilla. How many have heard of the gorilla in the German zoo? No one. I'm about to tell you about it. So now you're going to be enlightened. There was a gorilla and I was in Berlin last year too, and we're going back to Berlin, right in the heart of Berlin, taking the band in, taking the biggest place we can, right in the heart of Berlin next year. And then we're going to go from that and we'll have a stadium in Berlin. Berlin's great. But there was a gorilla in the zoo, this big stupid thing. No, it was a bear. It was a big bear, but the poor bear had been in this cage for so long. The cage was 12 steps and it was about 3 feet wide, and the gorilla had become a little mental. And so the gorilla would, what sort of animal am I talking about? A bear. This bear, it was a bear, not a gorilla. You're trying to confuse me, Ruth. It was a bear. And this bear wasn't a koala bear, it was a proper bear. Because a koala bear isn't a bear at all, it's a marsupial. But the bear was walking along and it'd be, I don't know how many paces that is. Come here quickly, please, Josiah. I need your help. You stand here and count the paces, please. You just count my steps, all right? Here's the bear. You count out loud, please. How many is that? How many now? 12 up. Now, get this right. You missed that one. You know you did. You ready? And you can make the grunting noise with me. You ready? No, I didn't hear it. You got to grunt and then count. You ready? Twelve. Nice work. Thanks for your help again this year. Every year, you're getting taller. What are they feeding you? Just food? Normal food. Well, it's incredible. You'll be married off probably a year or two now. Well done. Thank you, Josiah. 12 paces up, 12 paces back. People hated that bear. It was boring. It was the most boring animal in the zoo. Up and back. They would throw cigarette butts under its feet just to try and make it jump a little bit. Maybe they get a little jump, a little bit like a... just to get a bit of excitement in the cage. And they put glass in its food to try and kill it. They actually turned on this bear and hated it. So finally they built a big enclosure, big area like this room for the bear. They had tires swinging. They had a couple of lovely female bear with lipstick on that was... I don't know if they did. I'm just adding that to the story. It says the story. So they set the cage up next to this thing. So the day came for the bear to leave that cage and go into the big area. And they opened the door and the bear wouldn't go out. It stayed in there. It stayed in there. Limited in its thinking. Limited in its understanding. Finally, they had to set a fire in there to frighten the bear out. The bear walked into the big enclosure, and there in the big enclosure, the bear simply took 12 steps up, turned around, and took how many steps back, Josiah? You've got it, perfect. How many was that, Jacob? Well done. Josh? Caleb? Brad? How many, Brad? Correct. Well done. He's sharp. Brad sharp. 12 up, 12 back. So here's this huge enclosure. Swings, waterfalls, female bear. Everything there, and this stupid bear is restricted in its head. And as Christians, we limit ourselves in God. We limit what we can be. We limit what we can do. We put limitations on ourselves. We walk 12 paces up and 12 back because that's what we're used to when we live in a new environment called the kingdom of God that doesn't even have walls. It is unlimited. The Bible says that God is able to do exceedingly abundantly beyond anything we could ask, think, dream, or imagine according to the mighty dunamis power that is working within us. He is able to do exceedingly abundantly beyond anything. Can America have a revival? Bit of Dr. Pepper. You guys eat some weird stuff. Dr. Pepper failed in Australia. Australians couldn't stand it. They reckon it was like fly spray. Just to use it to try and kill the flies in the house. I don't mind it. See, God said to Abram, I'm your shield and your exceeding great reward. He said, that is fantastic, but I got a problem. I'm childless. I haven't got seed. And the problem is we've got too many churches that are happy to have the providing, protecting God who can do everything for them when there needs to be a cry in the church, give us souls like never before. God is actually looking for some people who are going to get on their face before God and press in until we see an explosion. California needs a move of God. I mean, you don't have to be Einstein to realize that California needs a move of God. How many are aware that California is in need of revival? I mean, I went into a church in California just recently, and I said to them, I said, we had a great weekend last weekend. I said, we're out dolphin shooting. And they put me out of the church. It's not true. I've never shot a dolphin, but I just wanted to see the reaction. I got quite an interesting one this morning. I've never shot a dolphin. I love dolphins. I can't eat a whole one, but it's another joke. It's another joke. No, I'm joking. I'm sorry. Somebody's got a rainbow-coloured flag being waved at the back. Somebody else got to sign up Save the Whales. Tim, move on. I'm going to. Really? Absolutely. Are you nervous? A little bit. Well, it is Southern Keller. You are. Yeah, move on. Well done. All right, moving on. Something happens when we begin to cry out for souls. I love the great soul winners. I love the great soul winners. I love them. Abraham said, Lord, I'm childless. The steward of my house is Eliezer of Damascus. And behold, you've given to me no seed. One born in my own house is mine heir. And the Lord said, no. One that's born from your own body, he'll be your heir. And he said, come on, come out under the stars and count them if you can. And he began to count them. It took a long time. The Lord said to him, you got it, Rob. It took him all afternoon, all evening. How many have tried to count the stars? One, two, three, four, five, a lot. So shall your seed be. Yongi Cho says every one of those stars turned into a face crying out, Father Abraham, Father Abraham, Father Abraham. Every one of them turned into a face. I was in the Solomons, first crusade I did there. I've probably told you this five times. I was preaching in the Solomon Islands. And I remember on the last night, we were right on a battle site. And being Veterans Weekend, I should have said something earlier, but I want to thank all the veterans because at Guadalcanal, and there in the Coral Sea, you saved Australia. America saved Australia in those two battles. Lost a lot of young men, but you saved us there. And if you're a veteran or someone in the services, I honor you, salute you today on this weekend. I remember the last night of this first crusade I ever did there. We had no room for an altar call. The whole stadium was filled. People were up in the trees. And I remember having this altar call, the only place to put people was around the fence, and there was maybe 5,000-6,000 around the fence. And I walked around the fence, and all these beautiful Solomon Island people had tears streaming down their face. And the Lord spoke to me, he said, you've been grafted into Abram. Abraham's vision is your vision. He never saw it fulfilled. The Bible says at the end of Hebrews 11 that without us, the faith of all those guys is not made perfect. And he said, you're grafted into Abram, and Abram's vision is your vision. And he said, have a look. And then he began, if I see the stars now, I start counting them because I want to see. I think we must be pushing towards a 2 million people saved now. But I'd like to have, it's not the dolphin story. There's a few leaving. I think they're a bit worried that this is just verse 3. Don't worry, we're not going to put you through too much more. I want to show you some things. I want to show you a couple of things. Yeah. And he looked towards heaven, and God said to him, so shall your seed be. And he believed God, and the Bible says God reckoned it to him for righteousness. And then he said, how do I know I'm going to have this thing? And the Lord said, take me a heifer of whatever, and a she-goat, and a ferret, and a bunch of... Well, let me tell you exactly. I can't add things like that. The Bible talks about adding to the gospel. Take a take a whole bunch of animals. Here we are. Take a heifer of 3 years old, and a she-goat of 3 years old, and a ram of 3 years, and a turtle dove, and a young pigeon. And he said, divide them, lay them down, except the birds. He laid them down. God showed him a vision and said, there's going to be a cost. There's going to be a cost. Yeah. I hear a lot of preaching today that we've got it all, just live in it. And that's some truth in that. I'm starting to get the heebie-jeebies here. Just hoping we've got someone left. You'll stay. Oh, good. Might be just Mark and I. Then I'll have an altar call. Pray for him, he'll pray for me. There's a cost. Now, I hear a lot of preaching today of, you know, we just got it all. But I study history, and I find that every revival of history was preceded by some people who refused to just sit by and say it's all going to happen, but began to touch God and said, we want to take the limit, and got before God and said, God, would you break the limits? Would you take the limits off? Would you take them off in me? Would you take the limits out in me? Would you take away from in me my unbelief? Would you break and snap the chains and let me start to dream bigger? I want to look at a couple of people quickly. I'm not going to preach too long. Let's have a look at a couple of people here quickly. Okay. Next one. Yeah. That's a picture that I like to show my grandkids just before bed. If they're not behaving themselves, my grandkids, I just hold that picture up and they go, what do we have to do to be saved? Who is that? Someone tell me who it is. Who is it? Charles Grandison Finney, a New York lawyer in the mid-1800s, had an impact that was so great on the other side of the nation, such a great move of God, that there were weeks where there were anything up to 50,000 people coming to Christ. Massive numbers got saved in his meetings, thousands and tens of thousands getting saved. He would send his prayer teams into a county to pray, and they would go in to break the chains and the shackles and to believe for something extraordinary, and they would pray so powerfully and so fervently that as people crossed the county line and horse and cart, they would tremble uncontrollably at the anointing. The anointing of God became so intense and the prayer so intense that they say that during the Great Awakening of the mid-1800s that there was a prayer meeting on every corner of every town and every hamlet and every city for 2,000 miles. And out from New York Harbor for 13 miles was a canopy of the power of God so intense that ships coming in into that canopy of power would come under the anointing of God and the entire cruise would be saved and arrive in New York Harbor singing choruses and worship, or singing worship songs to the Lord. Next one. That's the blue man from Las Vegas. There he is. Here we go. There he is again. Man, he got a set of eyes on him. You'd hang a picture like that out there in the field and be better than a scarecrow. Keep the birds off. Next one. The Cane Ridge Revival. After the Civil War, things were pretty desperate. And right at the start of the 1800s, about 1801, up until then, there were churches, not much was happening, but there were circuit riders. These guys would have a revolver on their hip and a Bible in their hand. Tough men, hard men. And they would travel around preaching the gospel powerfully. But in the midst of all of that, there were some breakthroughs with camp meetings, and probably the very first camp meetings, when we talk of camp meetings, they started at Cane Ridge in Kentucky. And they exploded out of prayer. And there would be preachers preaching in these huge areas. There might be 20 preachers preaching. Each one's got a crowd of 1,000, 5,000, 3,000. People are falling out under the power of God, screaming and shrieking. One man came up and he said, and he started to shake. He was an old, wild bushman that didn't want God. And he started to shake. And he said, I'll drink it away. I'll smoke it away. And he starts smoking. I'll drink it away to try and get it off his body. And then he says, I'll curse it away. And he started to convulsively shake so badly that his neck snapped, and they heard the snap of his neck as he dropped dead. There's a touch of God coming. America needs a touch of God. Not just mild, not just a nice lifestyle touch or a user-friendly touch. There needs to come the convicting power of God to such a dimension that people fall to their face screaming in repentance. This thing raged. They say that the preacher would preach and it was like a machine gun, like a Gatling gun, mowing them down under the power as they preached the gospel. That was in 1801. Did you know in Melbourne, Australia, there was a move of God with a guy called Torrey? A.R. Torrey? Torrey? Came to Melbourne, Australia, and he was getting 250,000 people a week coming to the meetings in the city of Melbourne that was only 1 million people. There are 250,000 people coming through those meetings per week. Where wouldn't that be? About the 1910s, 20 there somewhere. The biggest crowd at the Melbourne Cricket Ground in Australia, biggest sporting stadium, is Billy Graham, 140,000. Next one. I'll move quick. It's Cane Ridge. Next one. The Great Welsh Revival is one of my favorite moves of God. Evan Roberts was 13 years of age. It's not how old you are, it's when God touches you. Doesn't matter how old you are. Doesn't matter. You might be 13. The revival in Wales started when a 13-year-old was touched by the power of God. He was listening to a preacher by the name of Seth Joshua. Let's have a look at good old Seth there, I think. Thus saith the Lord. There he is. Fair sort of a moustache. A lot of people used to think he was a walrus, but he was a good man. Seth Joshua was preaching, and as he was preaching on being broken before the Lord and the fact that God wanted to do a huge thing. And as he was preaching, young Evan Roberts hung on to the back of the seat in front of him and began to cry out, God, break me! The nation was a disaster at that point. You could go to the local pub and they had straw lying down around the front of the hotel, and they'd put the price of a drink, the price of a bunch of drinks, and the price you had to pay to be paralytic lying out in the gutter on the straw. Place that was given over Had the Wesleys not risen up in England, they would have had similar to the whole situation that went through France. The Wesleys saved England from the guillotine in the middle of the streets. If you go to England, I've driven through parts of, well, I spent a lot of time in England. Driving along, a guy will say, yeah, that's where Wesley was here. Stay in a hotel in Sheffield, right next door. There's a place, he had a revival there and packed it out night after night. It's Wesley. Huge manifestations of God. Seth Joshua, maybe he's not very well known, but he preached a message one night that had the impact to change a 13-year-old boy. Let's have a look at the next one. We talk about, go back one there. We talk about the crowds. The revival broke out in Wales. Evan Roberts sought the Lord night after night after night in his teens. Into his 20s, he was spending all nights in prayer, crying out all night. He and his brother crying out hour after hour after hour after hour. And then one night, he was in his room with his brother and he began to shake. Evan began to shake. His brother said, what happened, Evan? He said, I've just been taken to the Mount of Transfiguration. He said, I saw the glory of God coming from the face of Jesus, and every time the beams from his face hit me, I trembled uncontrollably. He said, we're going to have a revival. A few weeks later, he was taken for about 4 hours into heaven, saw the streets of gold. Shook so convulsively, his brother thought he would die, and he came out unable to speak about what he'd seen. All he knew was they were about to have a massive revival. The revival broke out in the first month. It broke out at the exact day. It broke out in the north when a child asked her school teacher, teacher, do you know Jesus? And a whole school came out of the grip of God, which spread from there. The revival in the south was so powerful under Evan Roberts that they didn't advertise. People went to the halls following the feeling. Trains coming from England to the revival, coming down, they would ask the conductor, where do I get off the train? And the conductor would say, you'll feel it on the train, you'll know when to get off. No one will need to tell you. Where do we go to the revival? Follow it, you'll know where to go. Grown men would scream in a horror of their sin, trembling with fear that they would fall into hell. Is there something missing today? Is there have we limited the Holy One? Have we limited the Holy One of Israel? I have wasted years. Wasted. A whole nation so swept with the power of God that the newspaper wrote, the whole nation's under the grip of some unseen power that shows no sign of lifting its hand. Yeah. 30 years later, you can still feel, they say, you can still feel the weight of the anointing hanging over Wales. Can God do it again? Are we going to watch and say, look where everything's going? Or are we going to take the limitations off and say, God, not only can you, but you're going to? It only takes this group of church of people here committed. And I know you. I've watched you long enough to know the commitment. Revival can break out . I'm tired of watching humanistic nonsense in our nation. I'm sure you are in yours. Humanistic, godless, antichrist attitudes that flood the society until they become the norm and the expected. And the movies that makes sin right, and those that oppose the sin wrong. Let's shut the voice of the righteous and fill our kids' heads with nothing short of nonsense. Australia is becoming filled with nonsense. The church thinks it can do it on a painted cart with cattle. Church thinks it can bring the anointing back on a painted cart with a couple of bullocks. But the danger comes when they have to steady the ark. Because I read that the only way the ark, when David had the realization that it's not going to come back on a painted cart, every six paces the ground was covered in blood of sacrificed animals. And the prepared Levites, washed and holy, were carrying the ark with the staves on their shoulders. The road back to revival is not going to be methods. The road to revival is not going to be just good teaching. The road to revival is not going to be good preaching or brilliant academic knowledge or teaching. It's going to be on a road of blood with an understanding of the blood of Jesus and the willingness of our own lives, if necessary, to put ours there. And the weight of prayer upon the shoulders. I love Epaphras. The Bible says of Epaphras, who went down into the Lycus Valley. I think he probably was one of those that was raised up in the school of Tyrannus. I don't know. Epaphras. But he went into the Lycus Valley where Paul had been restricted to go. I was just in the Lycus Valley a few weeks ago. And he went down there, and just this ordinary guy went down and opened the great church at Hierapolis, Colossae, and Laodicea. We don't read that much about him except that Paul writes and says he labored earnestly in prayer for them. And that word labor earnestly in prayer is the Greek word agonizomai. And agonizomai is the word for, well, agon is the word from which we get agony. And the word agonizomai speaks of a wrestling or a conflict or an Olympic event in the stadium, or even to the degree of a gladiatorial boxing or wrestling, almost to the death in the stadium. The Apostle Paul said, a good fight, a beautiful fight I fought. When he uses the two words agon, from which we get agony, and agonizomai, an agonizing, beautiful warfare I have fought in the stadium or the arena of challenge in life. Epaphras has labored earnestly. Strongest word. Paul doesn't use words lightly. And when he uses the word agonizomai, it speaks of a man who has poured himself out. Like praying, John praying Hyde, who prayed for the Punjab region of India. I've been in the areas of Pakistan. Man, I'm hunting a few people out today. Preached in the Punjab area of India. Big conference coming. He took three men, himself and two others. He said, we'll fast and pray for 3 months. And we'll pray 24 hours a day and fast for 3 months. One would fast a week and then eat for a few days and then fast again. Another one would pray all day. Another one would be sleeping, and then he'd wake up, and when the other one finished, he would pray, and they'd pray into the night in shifts, and they kept going, and they kept going, and they kept going, and they kept going for 3 months, and they went to that conference. And when Hyde stood up at that conference, he stood in front of this multitude, a great crowd that was there. And he lifted up his hands and he cried out, my Father, my Father. And with that, the wind of God swept them to the ground, sobbing convulsively and weeping in heaps all over the ground. Can we take off the limitations? Can we? Can I? Can you? Can we? Pastor said next year we're going to Mongolia. As soon as he said it, I said, I'm in that. We're going back to Myanmar this year. Got a 50,000 seat stadium, two 20,000 seat stadiums, and we've already had 70,000 given to us and invested into that crusade before. That great Welsh revival. We look at those crowds, we think of crowds today. That's the turn of the last century. Crowds that flocked. John Wesley, riding his horse, came to a place at 6 o'clock in the morning and there's 20,000 people waiting to break bread and take communion. His voice was gone. He wrote in his journal something along the lines, I had no voice and nothing really came forth, but when I finished endeavouring to share, thousands were there, penitent. Whitfield, preaching on the gallows in London. As he's preaching from the gallows in London, where people have seen many executions, he's preaching, what then shall the end be to them that obey not the gospel of God? And as he's preaching, suddenly a man dies in the crowd. And they cried out, a man has died here. Preach on. And he preached on, and as he was preaching, what then shall the end be? Several died, and he kept preaching as they're carrying their corpses out, preaching to them about their eternity. Take off the limitation. I'm preaching to myself right now. If no one in the building is listening right now, I'm talking to myself. The Western Church. I just stood in Ephesus. And I stood next to that massive stadium, that great theatre where they bayed for his blood, where they cried for his blood. I'm still standing there today. And there's stadiums like that all around the world. But that's the only one that has Paul stamped on it, and it's probably the most significant. You walk 2 kilometres through Ephesus on the streets where Paul preached, probably past the houses where he preached. Fearless. Fearless. Unlimited in dream. Unlimited in courage. How great a thing can we do in the years we have? What can God do with you? You say, I'm just an ordinary person. Bible says, not many mighty, not many noble, but God has chosen the foolish things of this world and the base things, the things that are not, to confound the wise. God's looking for some people who'd say, I'm just a very ordinary person. You take a very ordinary person and get them filled with the very supernatural God. It's not by might, nor is it by power, it's by my spirit, says the Lord. Azusa Street, I'll share this one last one. Let's have a look there. Let's just go, that was miners coming back. The animals underground didn't even understand the language anymore. Next one. Azusa Street. It was a stable. Significant that the move of God in America would start in a stable. God seems to like to do things in stables. Do you know when Mary and Joseph rode in to Bethlehem, Herod had a great palace there that was one of the most palatial places on the earth. But Jesus wasn't born there. Azusa Street inspires me. I mean, I'm an Australian, but I love America, American history, American everything. You've got a fantastic country with so much incredible stuff that you've got to know about. This was the church. In that church, the meetings took place 3 times a day. People lay on the floor of that place sometimes for days, having visions. They would fan the blowflies. because in that place there are a lot of eggs of flies that had been laid and they painted over everything, but it was in that place that Daddy Seymour, that incredible African-American man, blind in one eye, smallpox that affected his face, he was disfigured in his face, rejected, had to sit outside the Bible College doors in Houston, Texas, when Parham was teaching. Wasn't allowed in because of the color of his skin. Went down to hit LA and took a church and got thrown out because he preached about a baptism of the Holy Spirit that he didn't have. And began to seek the face of God 5 hours a day, hour after hour after hour after hour after hour. Let's have a look at the guy. Next one. Five hours a day seeking the baptism of the Holy Spirit. He said, what do I do, God? And God said, step it up to seven. 7 hours a day crying out to God, crying out to God. I had a meeting in a house in Bonnie Bray Street. I don't know if I've got a picture of it there. Let's have a look at the next one. Little house in Bonnie Bray Street. He took a man called Mr. Lee, and I'm nearly finished. Mr. Lee got phenomenally baptized in the Holy Ghost and took off. There's a young woman, her name was Agnes, I think, someone, you didn't possibly know her name. She got hit by the power of God, jumped to her feet, ran to the piano, and began to play like a concert pianist. People began to sob and weep and scream and shout. People came from across the road and they crowded onto the veranda to such a degree that that little veranda began to break down and the floor of it began to give way with people all over that property gazing through the windows and up on that veranda gazing in to see what was going on. And then across the road, 50 yards away, they began to fall out under the power of God. And then it began to run day after day after day, hour after hour after hour, day after day. They moved into that big horse stable, just ran and ran and ran for, and every church in LA got touched. Wasn't just that, churches were catching fire all over Los Angeles. And then it was spreading all over the nation, out of that little house. We talk limitations. Out of that little house, the entire nation of the United States was changed. There are no limits. There are no limits. One of the leading skeptics, head of the Skeptic Society, came in. Sat in that meeting, white suit, cane with a gold top, arrogant, sat there. Daddy Seymour put his head into a fruit box. I began to cry out to God. Oh God. He would have spent most of his time sitting there with his head in a fruit box, an open fruit box, as the Spirit of God poured out, like a tap turned on. The skeptic, Daddy Seymour, said, let's pray. They began to pray. As they began to pray, the guy began to shake until he shook so convulsively that he took his hat off, shaking, put his cane down. Daddy Seymour said, continue to pray. A few minutes later, he fell from the seat onto the ground, trembling. And Daddy Seymour said, keep praying. A few moments later, they could hear the sound of the skeptic speaking in tongues as the Holy Ghost flooded him. We could talk today, and maybe tonight we could follow some of this a little further and touch a little more tonight. But God's speaking to us. He's speaking to me this morning. Like, God, He's speaking to me this morning. I'm not going overseas for 10 weeks when I get home. I went away in the mountains last year for a week. after I was with you, I think, just went away. I'm going to go away for a couple of weeks, right up in the northern Flinders Ranges. And 18 hours a day, I'm just going to seek the face of God. Because I'm limited. Too much like that bear. Too many limited habits. I look at any other person and say, is that the benchmark? Because I don't think anyone on the planet has yet set the benchmark of what can happen. There's only one. He spent 3 years just raising up 12 and 120. The day at Pentecost, the 120 were there. Now the whole world is waiting for the greatest manifestation of power that's ever been seen. The world is waiting for a manifestation of power that's never been dreamed, never been imagined, through vessels that are going to carry something that no person on earth, apart from Jesus himself, has been seen to carry. You say, how can that be? Jesus said, everything we've done, I mean, we can't do greater works than raise the dead or cleanse the lepers, but there's a lot of us now. And Jesus said, greater works are we going to do than he's done. Are we greater than Jesus? Not at all. There's just a lot more of us with a greater opportunity. Yes. Jesus wants to live his life through you. Your skin with Jesus totally controlling and filling and empowering you without limitation. The Bible says of Ephraim, the name Ephraim, I think Ephraim and Manasseh, I think it's fruitful, isn't it? Fruitful with all the weapons of war turned back in the day of battle. And we've seen a lot of that. But there's a lot of people right now who haven't turned back and aren't going to turn back. Amen. And I just have a feeling that I could be sitting with a bunch of people who have never understood what it is to turn back. Amen. Close your eyes with me. Come here, Rob. Come here, my friend. Come up this way, my friend. One of the best people I know. All over the world, I know hundreds and hundreds and thousands of people. But Rob and Randy are two people that I hold as incredibly special. Come here, Randy. And they've embraced me as the triplet. Lift your hands, guys. You want to understand the word faithful? Rob? Power from heaven. Power from heaven. Watch him. Power from heaven. In a new dimension. My God. Just close your eyes all across the building. Every one of us put limits on ourselves. We put them on. Whether we're young or old, male or female. Some people say, well, I can't do this because I'm too old. I can't do this because I'm too young. Moses said, I can't do this. I can't talk properly. God said, who made your mouth? I can't do this, said Gideon, because I'm the least in my father's family. Glory of God is in the house. The devil has not wanted this stuff preached. He hasn't wanted this stuff preached. Sometimes we can go a long time and go, when's it going to happen? I actually don't think that it's, I don't think that it is a coincidence that next door you've got a room that can seat 3,000 or 4,000 people. Jesus. Sister in the green, I've forgotten her name, my friend, come this way. Bless you. Come down this way. Man, it's only 1:30. Sorry about that. You all happy? What time do we finish here, Reverend, normally? About now? Let the power of God flow. Let the power of God flow right through you, right through you, right through you, like a fire, like a fire. Like a fire, like a fire, like a fire, like a fire. Every person in the building who would say, God, today I'm breaking the shackles. I'm going into a new place of prayer. I'm going after God like never before. I've limited you. I've limited you too long. If that's you, stand to your feet. Stand to your feet. Jesus. Come here, Caleb. Lift your hands up to God. Father, take hold of this young man and put a fire in his belly that cannot be expunged. Power from heaven. Come here, Jeremy. My God. Power from heaven. Jesus, touch him with fire today. Touch him with the fire of God. Come here, both of you. Come up this way. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Power from heaven. Power from heaven. Come here, my brother. Come up this way. Lift your hands to God. Never quite the same. Never the same. Power from heaven. Jesus' name. Come here, both of you. Both of you guys. Lift your hands up. Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, just touch him. Just touch them both. Touch them. Touch them. Touch them. Touch them. Touch them. Sir, would you come? Sister here, sister, lady with the stripes and the brother next. Just come. Just come. Just come. Come here, Adam. Holy Spirit, touch them both. Touch them both. That's it. The power of God is getting so strong here right now. Take it now. Take it now. Take it now. Right now. Right now. Right now. Right now. Just take it. Jesus' name. Jesus' name. Stay with me, guys. Jesus, 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 the anointing right now. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, Lord, thank you, Father, thank you, my God. David, come here, my bro. David, come. It is a new day, David. It is a new day. From here, there's a stepping. There's a step up, there's a step up, there's a step up, there's a step up. Seize it and grab it. I feel the Lord saying, grab, grab hold, grab hold. I'm taking you. Come here, Ruth. Bachelor of Calisthenics, Kisnostas, whatever. But she's got it, whatever it is, she's got it. It's all about physical stuff, very impressive. Power from heaven. What's it called? Kinesis, kinesiology. Come here, Tyler. Lift your hands. My God, power of the Holy Ghost, Jesus' name. Touch him, Lord, touch him, touch him. Stuart, come here, my friend. Thank you, Father, thank you, thank you. Thank you, Lord, thank you. Come here, bro, come up this way, come up this way. Lift your hands to God. As you do, heaven comes on you, heaven comes on you, heaven comes on you. Jesus' name, come here, Brad. I'll bring the whole family, Brad. Bring this whole crew. One of the leading smiles in Southern California. Josh, come here, my friend. The happy family. I don't even need to go to Disneyland. Another catcher, quickly. Oh, my God. Touch him. Touch him. Touch him. Touch him. Power, power,
power, power from heaven. Jesus, fill the happy man. Come here, Jonathan. We're running out of carpet here. You're going, it's like you're going to concrete. Jesus. Power from heaven. Power of the Holy Ghost. Sister, come. Just come. Help her down the stairs, guys. Yeah, just come. Just help her down. Look after her. Like royalty. Limitations off. How are you, sister? You doing good?
Not too bad.
You're looking lovely. Come and let me pray for you. These guys will look after you. A little bit of space here, guys. Just going to have to move that foot, Caleb, just slightly this way. Look out, Josh. Don't let him kick you. Come in, sister. My God, touch her today. And need some healing today.
Yes, my eyes. I have glaucoma.
Father, touch her right now. Let the pressure go right down. Right down, 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 down. Ah! Jesus' name. Your mighty presence, just fill her body. Fill her body. Everyone just reach out to God this morning and say with me, no limitations. Give me that water. A bottle of water, that's it. No limitations. I think we have limited God, Pastor. In our expectation, we've limited God. Annie, in our expectation, we've limited him. Haven't we? Jesus. Well, go easy. We've limited him, Pastor. Every limitation removed. My God, let the map of the world illuminate. Where's the guys? Where's my guys? Fellas, come with me. Jesus, let the map of the world illuminate with nation after nation. That whole Silk Road and way, way beyond. Power! Jesus. Come here, my brother. I've forgotten.
Robert.
Yeah, it is Rob. How are you? Hands up, Rob. That was just a... yeah. Power from heaven on you, Rob. Come here, sister. Sister's shining a lot. Jesus. Jesus. I keep looking at that little house up there. A little house with no limitations. Little house with no limitations. What can come out of your house? What can come out of the abiding house, abiding place? What can come out of here? It's already. Look at some of the stuff that's come out of here now. Look at what's happening in Nepal out of here. Historical move of God where a whole nation has been impacted from here. Power from heaven. Jesus, just touch you. Come here, sister. Just come. Yeah, bring sister and brother and bring that row. Bring that row. Holy Spirit. Holy Jesus. Come on, both of you boys, come up here. Lift your hands up, fellas. Power from heaven. Filled with the Holy Ghost, Jake. There he goes, he's a champion. They're champions. That's Josh. Everyone put your hand on the shoulder of the person next to you. Sister? Not injured?
was a Marine dropped you. Jesus. Marines aren't supposed to drop anyone. What's happening, Tyler? Pah! Up from heaven. There's a tremendous anointing of God here right now. I want you to just close your eyes and let the Lord speak to you. How can He take off the limitations? How can He do it? What do you have to let go of? Where are the restrictions in our lives? What are they? Is it what we think we can do? Is it because we limit ourselves? Come up here, Geneva. I want to pray for you. And Dave, you can have the rug, and poor old Dave gets the concrete. That's fair. That's fair. Jesus, touch these two. Last I talked to you, you were planning some stuff. San Diego, shaken by the power of God. Shaken. 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 Just on the seat in the front, let it, sister, just sit there for a couple of minutes on that seat, and we'll gonna pray some more for her in a moment. Let's just spend a moment. Let the Holy Spirit speak to you. We're going to close in a minute. Jesus, Father, we thank You this morning. There is no limit. Just take a seat and keep your hands raised, reach out to the Lord. Father, there's nothing impossible. There's nothing impossible. There's nothing impossible. Fill those hands with healing power. Fill those hands with the lightning fires of God. Touch those lips with the coal from the altar. Let the supernatural power of God flow through every person in this building. And let us be changed forever. Change forever. Change forever. Just spend a moment and pray for the person right next to you. Pray for the person right next to you. Let the glory of God just fill this house. I've known Pastor Mark now for, and Annie and the family, for probably 15 years, I guess. I reckon I've been coming here for 15 years. And in that time, I've seen Nepal shaken from one end to the other with a move of God that has seen a whole nation transformed. I've seen Mark go into New Guinea. He's come with me into New Guinea and did some preaching, and then went back himself and had fantastic meetings, touching them in the power of God in New Guinea. China's opened up, and most extraordinary things happening in China. And beyond that, there's all these nations that I got no idea what different nations you've been into, but it's a lot. But it's all out of here. There's teams that have gone in and out of here, and there's more that are going to go. But I almost feel like God's given you favor to the nations that is unique.
a heavenly man, comes and connects himself with this church. Leaders across China come and connect themselves. It's a day of big things. I was in a small church in Turkey a couple of weeks ago. It's only small, it's about 300 people, and it's the biggest Pentecostal church in Turkey. First service was in French, next one was in English, and the last service of the day was in Turkish. There had been 120 people there, that most of them had been Muslims who are now Christians. And there's a big man in the meeting standing there, 6'2 or 3, an African man. And I laid my hands upon him and the power of God hit him like a bolt from heaven. I said, pick him up. And I prayed for him a second time and the power of God hit him, and I prophesied miracles like never before and prophesied these things. I didn't know much about the man. He came up to me afterwards and he said, I'm an evangelist from Africa. He said, I travel all over Africa, and he said, we're doing a crusade in Ethiopia next year. And he said, there'll be 200,000 people in the meeting, but we want you to come and be the speaker. I said, let me pray about it, yes. Let me pray about it, yes, I'm coming. But I've been asking the Lord. I told him recently, I said, Lord, I preached to 100,000 people, but I want to touch multitudes. Now the invitation's there to touch anything up to 250,000 people per night. And see, maybe 50, 60, 80,000 or more people per night get saved over 5 nights. Now 300,000 saved over a few nights. Back into Myanmar. And I've been saying, God, is there the biggest stadiums in the world? We want to fill them and see whole nations change in a day, change in a week. Hallelujah. Let's all take our seats for a couple of moments. Tonight I'll spend time praying for the sick. The message this morning was really a challenge. I feel very challenged myself, looking at those pictures and thinking about those men and women that have led the way and done the extraordinary. As we're just in prayer for a moment, are there those in church today, and I know I've preached a while, but are there those that have never found Jesus? You're backslidden. You've never found him. Would you like to know him today? You'd like to know Christ today? You'd like Jesus to come into your life and make you new? You're away from him. You want to come back. But just say, I'd just love to know Jesus today. I'd like a living relationship with him. I want my sins gone. I want Christ to truly be my Savior, my Lord. Would you lift your hand wherever you are? Just lift it up, and God bless you, right in the back row. Is there someone else? Just lift it up. You say, I want Jesus today. Lift it up so I can see it. Someone in the back row there. Is there someone else? Quickly. Someone else. God bless you, ma'am. Is there someone else? Thank you. God bless you, my friend. God bless you. Is there someone else? Someone else? You want Jesus today. Is there someone else? It's the most important thing today. That you be saved, that you know that Christ has come to indwell you. Let's all stand together. Those that have lifted their hand, I'd like you to do something. If you lifted your hand and said, yes, I want Jesus, I'm going to ask you if you could just make your way down here to the front. I'd like to just pray a little prayer with you this morning. Would you come, dear sister there? Someone come with her. Can I pray for you this morning, ma'am? Dear lady here. That's it. Someone come with her. Anyone else that's lifted their hand and said, yes, I want to go too. Just come. Bring your friends. Turn to your friend and say, if you'd like to give your life today, I'll go with you. I'll go with you. And just come right down here. I want to pray for you. Just want to meet you and pray for you. Hello. Come with me. Come up with me.
Let's see. Come up this way. Young people, and we're going to go up this way, meet our sister. How about that? Phil, the bachelor lady. Have you done this before? Never done it before. God bless you. You've done this before? Yeah. Anyone else? Anyone else you want to make that step for the Lord today? Anyone else? Just pray this simple prayer with me. We're all going to pray it. Dear Heavenly Father, I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of the living God, that He died on a Roman cross to cleanse me from every sin that I have ever committed. Today, Lord Jesus, I open my heart to You. Ask You to come in and make me a brand new person. I'm Yours. In Jesus' name. Amen. Now, I'm going to pray for you now. Father, just come around with the guys. Look after her. Touch this dear lady and let her feel heaven's glory all over her today. Bless her. Touch her and let her know that You've come into her life, that You're her personal Lord and Savior, and that You'll never leave her nor forsake her. Jesus, thank You. Get someone to have a chat with her in a minute. Is that okay? Let me pray. What's your name? Zoe's a good name. The God kind of life. Touch Zoe today, Father. That's it. Hello, Annie. How are you? You're doing quite well? Jesus, the anointing. Just like a fire from heaven. It's not. Is that Brooke? No, it's not. I know. You look like Brooke. It's amazing, isn't it? Did you hear some stories the other night from Disneyland? Brooke was really complaining that she didn't get to go. Jesus. Jesus. You know what? I just feel like we should let that word sink into our hearts. If you need healing in your body, just put your hand on the sick part right now. Christians nearby, if you need a miracle, just lift your hand and Christians are going to gather around you here. Because more people get healed when everybody prays than... Some Christians nearby, just lift your hand so we know who you are. Look around, folks, and when you see a hand, just lay your hand on that person. Would you do that? There's a lady with a hand raised there. Just find someone. And Father, we pray the prayer of faith right now. We declare the healing power of God. We declare Your miracle power. Thank You right through the building. Thank You, Lord. In Jesus' name.
Amen. Thank You, Lord Jesus. There is a river that makes glad the city of the Lord. Father, we thank You. You gave us this river. Hallelujah. Thank You, Jesus. Thank You, Lord Jesus. Thank You for Your healing anointing. Hallelujah. Ha ha. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, I command you to be completely and totally healed now. That the sickness and the disease no longer be able to exist, the pain, the torment, whatever the problem, it ceases, comes to an end now in Jesus' name. The name of the Most High God, in Jesus' name, everything's changed. You're released right now. Released from sin, released from sickness, released from disease, released from pain and torment to live the rest of your life worshiping and praising that wonderful name by which we've been redeemed, that name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Everybody say with me, say, thank You, Lord Jesus. Thank You, Lord Jesus. Ha ha. Woohoo. Woo-hoo. Well, we want you to come back tonight at 6. We're going to take up right where we left off. And we want you to be in prayer and praise and thanksgiving with us that over the next 4 days, things will just continue to build. We won't have to retrace our steps. We won't have to start back over in the starting place. But rather we'll take up each meeting from the place where we left off till you can't walk in the building. Amen. And we'll just get, then we'll have some stretcher bearers come pick you up and bring you in. Amen. Hug a bunch of people around you. Tell them that you love them.